Once again, thank you for coming. It's a wonderful workshop about temporary residents and home buying. It's really exciting. We are going to learn a lot, and we are going to have good information. I think others will join us when we are listening. So, Jennifer, I wanted really to thank you, and just go ahead. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much, Azarias, and thank you all for coming. I know that this prohibition on purchase of residential property for non-Canadians has kind of thrown a little bit of a wrench in the purchasing for people who are temporary residents. So I just wanted to come on here and speak to what I deal with, and you're welcome to ask me any questions with regards to the real estate process as it pertains to this or just in general. So basically, prior to January 2023, this wasn't a rule. So this only happened in this year, January. And why it happened, why the government did this, was that they thought it would be a good way to cool the high prices of the market. They took this initiative. So they made it a rule that non-permanent residents could buy a property, period. Now that has since been amended. March 27th, actually, a few months ago, they amended to allow non-permanent residents, temporary residents, the ability to apply for a mortgage to buy properties, provided they have a work visa in place, and it's still valid for no less than 6 months or 183 days. There are certain qualifications that need to be met, and lenders have their own internal qualifications to lending. And Brian will talk about that. Lenders basically just want to know that when you do purchase through mortgage, that you're willing to stay. That's the big push from lenders. Now, there are exemptions to the act, of course. Some of those exemptions are when you receive an interest in residential property due to divorce, separation, gift, or by death, when non-Canadian rents a dwelling for the purposes of occupying it, when a non-Canadian purchases a residential property for the purposes of development. This does not apply to Indigenous people. It does not apply to non-Canadian spouses or common law partners of Canadian citizens, permanent residents, or Indigenous people. Now, I'm going to let Brian get into the inner workings of what you need. I mean, I could list them off, but honestly, he has a better idea of all that. I don't qualify buyers. The only way that I qualify buyers is just as a first-time home buyer would. I sit down with you and I find out if you've been to the bank. And that's your first step, really, is to speak to a lender. Make sure that you have everything that they need to qualify you as a temporary resident for a mortgage. And then I step in and I sit with you. We find out what you're looking for. You are allowed to buy up to $500,000. So we would find your criteria and put that together. And then I would send you listings. When you find some that you like, I take you on showings, and then we go through the whole process with that. Now, new Canadians are not allowed to buy farmland, anything zoned agricultural. So if you're leaving the city limits, that's one of the things that you can't buy. You cannot buy farmland. And I know that some lenders want to make sure you come from a country where there is no label of terrorism. That was a big thing. Now, there are obviously websites that you can speak to or that you can look on. There's budgets on CMHC. It's the Canadian Mortgage and Housing Corp. And there's also a place called Sagen. S-A-G-E-N. It's got a new to Canada program that you can look up. So that's my part of this presentation. I certainly expect questions at the end of it, but I'm going to pass it to Brian, because Brian will show you how to qualify yourself for this program.
If we have a presentation, Brian, I can make you the host, co-host.
Actually, Azarius, Kieran has the presentation. So,
yes. So, should I start the presentation first, or?
Yeah, if you want to maybe share the screen.
Okay.
And as you're doing that, I can just start speaking to just the first or two slides there. But
Kieran, you can share the screen. Okay, thank you.
Perfect. Thanks, Kieran. So if we could, we'll go to the second slide there, Kieran. So just, I just want to do a quick brief review because again, we are a financial institution. We're a credit union, Assiniboine Credit Union. We don't know the policies and procedures related to all the financial institutions out there. We can really only speak to our own. However, we do have a lot of, we are all guided by the similar organization of CMHC and Jennifer mentioned Sagan. Sagan, weird name. We don't know why they changed it to that. It used to be called Genworth, but now they're called Sagan. So we're all adjusting to that, but most all financial institutions that finance what we call high ratio mortgages lean on Sagan and CMHC for insurance coverages. So we'll just kind of speak to our actually Kieran's going to do all the talking, but I just wanted to introduce and give you a little brief history of Assiniboine. Assiniboine is a financial cooperative. We have over $5 billion in assets. We offer everything from personal accounts to wealth planning to commercial financing to nonprofit financing. We can do it all. We have 14 branches located in the city. We have two up north, one in Thompson, one in Gillam. And we have 140,000 members, and we've been around for a long time. We've been around for about 75 years. So we just celebrated our 75th anniversary last year. So my name is Brian McIver. I'm the branch manager at Regent. But I'm going to pass it over now to Kieran Betty. She's a financial account manager at Regent, and she does a lot of mortgage financing. So she has seen a lot of types of mortgages come across her desk. So she can take it from here.
Thank you so much, Brian, for introducing me. Thank you all the participants who are giving me opportunity this evening. My name is Kiranjit Bedi. I am financial account manager at Regent Branch. I am in the financial industry over 10 years. And as a lender, I'm working last 5 years. With the ACU, I am working 1.5 month ago. So today I am doing some non-Canadian resident home buyer, like first time home buyer. There are some rules, as Jennifer mentioned earlier, January 2023, there was some restrictions, ban was made by Canadian government that the first time home buyer, there was some rule and regulations they made. But in March 27, 2023, they made some amendment where there was some exception was made so that people can buy some properties. So the non-Canadian acts apply who are neither a Canadian citizen nor Indian, non under an Indian Act and non-permanent resident. So basically like a work permit people or student visa people. So who are called temporary visa or non-Canadian residents. So
sorry to disturb you. I'm sorry, there is someone who wrote, kindly put the PowerPoint in a presentation mode. It's difficult to see the text as it is. Somebody wrote this.
Maybe
you can put slideshow and.
Is it working now? Is it better now?
No. It's still in. I think just click on the icon there, the one near the percentages where you have the percent on the lower right corner.
Lower
right corner. Yeah. The icon. No. Okay, the fourth one. Not that one. No. Next. No. The one, yeah, that one.
This one? Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Oh, there you go.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. But how? Okay, got it. Thank you.
Just use the arrows on your desk, on your keyboard.
Sounds good. Perfect. I learned something new. Okay.
Thank you. Sorry for that.
Yeah. No worries. Okay. Non-Canadian buyer themselves are the responsible to ensure they are eligible for the purchase of resident property, while the prohibition on the purchase of residential property by non-Canadian Act is enforced. So it's not a bank, it's not financial institution, it's not a lawyer, or it's not any real estate responsibility. So it's a non-Canadian non-Canadian buyer themselves are the responsible. So as I mentioned previously, and the status in Canada, the requirement, temporary resident studying in Canada. So they have to enroll in a program authorized study as a designated learning institution as defined in the Immigration and Refugee Protection Regulation. File income taxes for each of the five taxation years preceding the years in which the purchase was made. So physically present in Canada for minimum 244 days in each of the five calendar years, the years which the purchase was made. So the property purchase, the limit should not be exceeded for 500,000. Temporary resident working in Canada, which means work permit, people who are on work permit. So they have to hold a valid work permit or authorization, authorized to work in Canada, have 183 days or more validity remaining on the work permit or work authorization. So what that means, so they should, the time they are purchasing the property, they should have a 6-month valid work permit. So have not previously purchased a resident property in Canada while the prohibition is in effect. As you know, this ban is right now, they said it's for 2 years. So they shouldn't have, since they are buying the property, it should be primary resident. It should not be a rental or investment property. Non-Canadian spouse and common law partner. So if somebody is buying the property, but their spouse is or common law partner who is a Canadian citizen or a person registered under the Indian Act, a permanent resident or non-Canadian for whom the prohibition does not apply. So this rule does not apply. So now I am just introducing what's ACU rules and regulation. Every financial institution have their own guideline. Here today, I'm just explaining or leverage my knowledge, whatever expert advice or whatever things we offer. So great expert advice. Let's get moving on a mortgage that is right for you. So where we help to find an ownership journey, calculate how much you can borrow, what your payment will be, and also help you a pre-approval process. This advice I'm sharing with you, it's an ACU. As I told, every institute has their own guideline. So first of all, when you are new to Canada, you have to have established good credit score to purchase anything, any credit. So why is a good credit score important? A good credit score help you qualify for a loan, lower interest rate when you borrow. This will help you buy a car, get a mortgage, pay for schooling, qualify for lower interest rate for credit cards or more. So credit score, how your credit score is calculated, it's depending on the payment history, current debit, length of history, new inquiries, and type of credits. For second step, when you are applying for any credit inquiry, especially a mortgage, the down payment. So for non-Canadian residents, now the new rule is they have to have 10% minimum down payment required. Most of the financial institution like to see your down payment, most recent 90 days bank statement from whichever accounts the down payment is coming. So when you are looking for pre-approval for a mortgage or the final mortgage, your lender will ask you to 90 days, there should be a down payment deposit into your account. Some businesses, they work as a cash, they don't deposit the money into their accounts right away. But then when the time is to purchase their primary home, that time the financial institution can't help them because there is no down the 90 days history. So if member wants to purchase a property, it has to have in their bank account. It should not be under the pillow or anything. So the resource of down payment is from your own savings, your RRSP savings, or your TFSA. So the next step is purchase your home. It's exciting, but it can be overwhelming too. Like, what will be your household income? What will be the amortization, down payment, interest rate, those things. So when we do pre-qualification, when we give pre-approval, that is good. It's a subject for 90 days approval, the good credit, and it's good for 90 days. And we give our pre-approval with the court for guaranteed 120 days. So your interest rate is good for 120 days. There is two type of mortgage, one called high ratio mortgage and second one is conventional mortgage. The difference between high ratio mortgage and conventional, the high ratio mortgage is a insured mortgage when member is putting less than 20% down. So when member is putting less than 20%, it has to be go either a CSN or a CMSC. But when member is able to do more than 20%, then we do a conventional mortgage. On conventional mortgage, we don't charge any premium, so you can save up a money. And also for your down payment, as I previously mentioned, the down payment also can come from RRSP. If you guys know that when we do RRSP deposit, when anyone withdraw the funds, there is a tax brackets. Everybody has to pay some taxes on RRSP because it's tax-free saving, right? RRSP is a registered saving plan, but when you try to withdraw, there is a tax bracket implement for everyone. But when any person purchase a primary home, first-time home buyer, they can withdraw up to $35,000 at tax-free. There will be no deduction, but member has to pay those payments within next 25 years. I also want to inform, when you are purchasing a home, there is a lots of cost involved in purchasing a home. So there is mortgage payment, monthly property tax, fire insurance, optional payment protection, which means life insurance, disability, critical illness, utility, hydro, water, maintenance, and repairs. So we not only just do a pre-approval or a mortgage for you, we also inform you that now you purchase your house, your dream house, but you also have to consider if there is unexpected costs for home ownership, like emergency purposes, something breakdown, repair come in, or maybe one of the partner lose their job. So we also suggest some savings, and that time we refer you our wealth specialist, like expert specialist. Any question or answer at this point?
Maybe if we look on the chat, I think
there are some questions.
The chat, I think it has been answered. They were asking about the TFSA. What is TFSA?
It's a tax-free saving account. So every person is allowed $6,500 every year to put it into TFSA, but there will be no tax on that money.
What we tend to find is a lot of people that are really looking at getting pre-approved. Some of the key components is obviously saving up the down payment, establishing a good credit history. So in some scenarios, we would recommend if someone doesn't have a credit history to seek out like maybe a credit card to start actively creating a credit file for yourself. We try and work closely with individuals that maybe have a little bit longer term horizons on buying a house. So let's say they say 3 years from now, we want to buy a house. You know, that's great. So it gives us 3 years to plan, 3 years to put a plan together to save. And maybe this individual has no credit. So maybe we do like in some scenarios, we'll do like an investment. We'll say, okay, well, we're going to give you a loan for $3,000 and we're going to hold that $3,000 as our collateral. So you don't get to see a penny of it. But when you pay off that loan, you've now established a credit history for yourself, registered with Equifax and TransUnion, which all the financial institutions access. And when you pay off that loan, your $3,000 becomes free to you to use as your down payment. So it's sort of two birds with one stone approach. So there's a lot of creative ways that we can recommend people start putting a savings plan, building a process to making that house a reality. So understanding the time horizon is really critical for us. So we've had scenarios where we've had people with negative credits. So, okay, well, that's not the end of the world. What can we do? Let's take a look at your situation. You know, how do we resolve this? If we can try and do a consolidation loan, maybe to pay up some credit that's gone negative, then let's try and do it. Maybe we have to pull a cosigner into it just to get through that situation. But again, we will work and be very transparent. Most all lenders will be like that. They will be very transparent to what you need to do to get, you know, to make that house a reality.
And isn't it also a qualification that you have to have the closing costs, not just the down payment? So closing costs, to those of you who don't know what that is, we usually use an estimate of 2 to 2.5% of the purchase price. A $200,000 house, you're looking at $4,000. Yeah. Now, within that range, you're looking at paying land transfer tax. It usually covers your lawyer. Property tax to the seller for the portion of time that you have possession of the property that they may have prepaid, disbursements, registration of title, all of that is called closing costs. That's in addition to your down payment. It's not included. So that's something to know. And I will ask those questions. So will the lenders. I know that's part of this program as well, or this act, pardon me.
Yeah, that's a very good point, Jennifer. I mean, you've covered it off perfectly. You know, it's down payment plus 2%. So if someone has told us that they have 10%, is that what they're buying their house with? We would say, okay, we need to see 12. If someone says they have 5%, we need to see 7. So hopefully it's not that much. Hopefully maybe it's a little less than 2%, but normally it isn't. Yeah, so maybe more, like Jennifer said too. So, but it's something to be prepared about. And I mean, we talk about different options with how you pay your taxes. Some financial institutions can set up what we call PIT, which is principal, interest, and taxes. So you have your mortgage payment, and let's say your taxes are $200 a month for your house. They can add that in a sense to your mortgage payment. So we collect. If your mortgage payment is $800, then we can add $200. So it's $1,000 a month we take, and $800 goes to your mortgage and $200 goes to your tax account. And then we send that money to the city of Winnipeg every June to pay your property taxes. We're playing kind of the middleman there. So in most cases, we would prefer you go on what's called the TIPS program with the city of Winnipeg, where the city of Winnipeg will just go right into your bank account once a month and take what they need. So there's never going to be a shortfall because you're dealing directly with the city. Whereas when you're dealing with a financial institution, we're always playing a bit of a guessing game because we don't know exactly to the penny how much we need to collect from you. So we usually collect more than we really need to make sure there's a bit of a safety net. So still a great program though. So, but I would recommend TIPS over setting it up with us because it's just more direct to the city and you will never have any surprises.
And TIPS is TPPS, right?
Yes.
So don't type in TIPS, T-I-P-S. you won't get what you're looking for online. Well, maybe not.
What the acronym stand? I think tax installment payment. Plan, maybe?
Payment plan, maybe?
Payment there plan. There you go. There we
T-I-P-P.
Go.
T-I-P-P, yeah.
If we have questions, please feel free to ask questions. I really want to thank Jennifer and Brian and Kiran for this information. You know, when we come from our countries, we have our own way, our own rules and regulations buying houses. But when we come here, things are different. And we really need this information. Yeah. We don't want to make any mistakes. Yeah. I really thank you for this information. It's really vital to us, we the newcomers to Canada. And I once again want to ask the participants if there is any question or any comment or
and if there are questions later on, maybe someone's shy or something pops up later, I mean, certainly Azarius or Cody can reach out to Brian, Kieran, or I to answer.
Definitely.
So are you going to share the slides or the recording of the presentation?
He's asking if you are going to share the PowerPoint, Kieran. Are you willing to share the PowerPoint?
Sure.
Okay.
And I've been recorded, so everything I said can be used again.
Yeah, I will send an email to Cody and Jennifer.
Thank you.
Maybe if I can ask a question, maybe for you talked about the insurance for those who are paying less than 20% as down payment, and those who are paying 20% and more conventional mortgage. Is it possible for you to talk about this this insurance, elaborate more about this insurance, the mortgage default insurance?
So the person who are paying less than 20%, this insured companies, Sagen and CMSE, they charge a premium, which is around the 4% of the purchase, like a down payment of the purchase. So if somebody is purchasing, suppose 400,000 house and 400,000, and if they are putting 5% down, there is some different, it's not for 4%, sorry. It's depending on if they are putting 10%, then there is a lesser bracket for a premium insurance. But if it's somebody purchasing a 400,000 house, 5% of that is 20,000. And member will be paying the premium on 20,000. So, but if somebody is putting 20% down towards the mortgage, which is conventional, they can save that premium fee, which is like which is like probably around 8,000 to 10,000, depending on the purchase. So suppose, example, somebody is purchasing 400,000 house. If they purchase in only 5% with CMSC, the down payment will be 20,000 and 4% of that, oh, sorry. Let me do some calculation.
4% of the 380.
380, yeah. Yeah. So which will be 4% will be 15,200. So member has to pay 15,200 in 25 years, that amortization, that premium. But if member is putting 20% down, we don't charge any premium fees. Member can save that 15,200.
It's very common that we see at the at the financial institution that a lot of first-time home buyers always need to lean on that. I mean, I did. You kind of look at it and you weigh it out. It's like, okay, I got 5% now, or 5% plus 2. My closing is 7%. I have 7% today. Do I buy a house today, or do I wait 4 more years to save up the balance of the down payment to keep it conventional? Well, if you wait 4 more years, you got to wait 4 more years and pay rent for 4 more years. And chances are that house will appreciate in value that you were looking at today significantly in the next 4 years. So it's, you know, weighing out the pros and cons. It's a hefty premium that the CMHC and SAGAN charge, but it's obviously up to the individual to decide, okay, should I jump into it today, or should I wait till I save that 20%? And more often than not, people say, I want to get into my house today. I need a house. I need that security, and start paying down that mortgage today versus waiting for 3 years. So again, it's individual choice, of course, but usually it's the second home that we start seeing people coming in, and they sell their first home, and they have a bit of a profit that they come out of it, and they have a bigger payment to put on the second home. So therefore then they finance the second home by conventional, by putting more than 20% down, so avoiding CMHC. So that tends to be what we see, and I'm sure Jennifer sees that as well.
Absolutely, yeah, for sure.
And that premium is added to the mortgage for 25 years. So now suppose it's 400,000 house with the 5%, 380, the premium added to the mortgage. So the new mortgage start at, instead of 380, premium added, so 395,500.
Yeah, it's very rare for someone to actually put down 20% in their first home, as Kieran and Brian were saying. I work with a lot of first-time home buyers, new Canadians, and although some actually have quite a bit of money that they've brought to Canada and they would like to use all of it because of those fees, we have a discussion to see if we're buying a property that maybe needs a bit of renovation or a bit of upgrading. Maybe you want to hold that back because, I mean, the interest rate, they're pretty low. Even though they've crept up, they're still pretty low versus having a loan to make those renovations. So we have all those conversations in the beginning, as you would with your lender. So that's part of what realtors do as well.
That's a good point, Jennifer. I think maybe just to touch on that too, is like purchase plus improvements is quite common out there as well. So what that means, let's say you found a home that's perfect and it's 360,000, but it needs a new kitchen and it maybe needs some work on the roof, and that's going to cost you 40,000. You can do what's called purchase plus improvements. So when you see your financial institution, you inform them of that. So they do that right out of the gates, in a sense, when you're doing your purchase. So now your purchase price goes from 360 in the eyes of the financial institution. We're going to change that number to 400 because you're going to take 40,000 out for renovation. Now we have to monitor that renovation. We'll need to send appraisers out. We'll need quotes and all that stuff, but it allows you to put that renovation into your mortgage on day one versus trying to take out a personal loan after a year or two. And if you have to take out a personal loan for renovation, you're not going to get a 25-year term to pay it off like you would with your mortgage. you'll get.
And correct me if I'm wrong, like the buyer or owner of the new home has to pay for those materials and labor, or negotiate with the contractor that the labor comes after and are reimbursed after the appraiser comes in to verify that everything's been done?
Yes, exactly. Okay. That's the challenging aspect of it, because sometimes it's a matter of the contractor wants this, and usually it has to come out of the pocket of the buyer to fund it up front. So at times, if we can, we will try and bridge that by giving maybe a temporary line of credit to fund the cost. And then when the mortgage is disbursed, it pays out our line of credit and we close it. So
okay, that's good to know.
There's a lot of ways we can try work around that to help the customer out.
And it can't be your brother, Ben, with no licensing contract. It has to be a licensed contractor who provides quotes that have insurance, is my understanding as well.
And the scary one is when people say, I'm going to do it myself. So that is not 100%, that's not restricted, but it becomes a lot more challenging because we need progress reports. So we'll send out an appraiser if it's a significant project to make sure the job was done properly and professionally. But that's something you would discuss with your realtor and your banker.
Maybe to Jennifer, the realtor, with this high interest rate, have you observed a slow purchase of houses or?
That's a very good question, Azarius. I would say the first, because I think there have been eight, correct me if I'm wrong, Kieran and Brian, I think there have been eight. But the first four or five hikes really slowed our market. And they were intended to slow down Vancouver and Toronto, as always. But what they do is they have unintended consequences for the rest of the country. So we saw everyone kind of stop buying for a period of time, which then also stopped people from listing their homes. So it was very, very slow and low inventory, and people weren't buying quite the same. And then by the fifth raise, I think people have just decided that if they want to buy a house, this isn't going to stop. They just have to maybe arrange their finances differently or have expectations that fall in line with the new interest rates. So their pre-approval will have lessened when the interest rates have gone up, because there's also the stress test, right? So you add 2%. To answer your question, 1 to 5, absolutely. 5 to 8, not so much. People have just pivoted, as we all do.
The stress test is how much now?
It's typically 2% over the market rate. So.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Yeah.
And that's the 5-year rate, Brian?
Yeah. Yes. Yeah, we do.
And Kieran, 5-year fixed, right? 5-year fixed. Okay. Thank you.
We're listening to a lot of economists, and we are also kind of projecting that rates will drop in the next 2 years. We're starting to see a bit of it already. Like, we've dropped our rates 2 or 3 times in the last 3 months, 2 months. So they're starting to, and I suspect they'll continue to fall. So we're 5 years is always a good term to consider when you're a first-time home buyer, because what it does is it locks in your mortgage payment for the next 5 years. You don't have to worry about it. In 5 years, it's up for renewal. Then you got to decide again what you want to sign up for, if it's a 1 year or a 5 year again. Right now, we're seeing a lot more people going into like 2-year terms, because the outlook is, hopefully in 2 years from now, rates will be a lot better. And then at that point, locking back into a 5-year. So
interesting.
Yeah.
Know that. I don't know if we have questions.
Sorry, I have questions.
Yes, go ahead.
First of all, sorry for my English. And if I knew here, so I have arrived 2 months ago only, how long should I live here to have a chance buy house? So how long should I build my credit score, or how it called, and what's the options do I have
to build a credit? We usually want to see when purchasing a home, we want to see at least minimum 1 year history. Okay. When you are purchasing a home, there, if you are putting like 20%, there will be some rules, like there is some another exceptions, like suppose instead of you only have 8 months or 9 months, then we consider maybe 1 year rental history. Any lease under your name or any bill payment you are paying for 1 year, that will also be a part of credit approval. But minimum, at least we need to see 1 year.
1 year, okay.
Yes.
Okay, and I've also been told, and I with other lenders, I've been told that there might be a case-by-case basis, which means if you apply, they might take your case with your specific information, and they might allow a lesser amount. I've heard as low as 3 months of pay statements, but I don't think that's the norm, but there might be a possibility. It's case by case. So I would say if you're unsure, you know, wait another month. You said you've been for 2 months?
Yes.
Yeah, so just wait at least another month, and then maybe you can investigate whether any lender would at that time consider 3 months of, have you been working for 3 months?
No, only two.
Okay,
yeah.
Oh, of course, yeah. So of course, 2 months, you've only been here 2 months. So when you have 3 months of pay statements, there might be some lenders out there that may consider it. So I would try then. And if it didn't work then, you maybe wait for 6 months. And then, you know, if they keep telling you, then you go to a year. But I know that I've heard some lenders will consider 3 months, but it's dependent on your particular case.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Another question. Thank you. Another question. If I came here for this quiet program for Ukrainian, so I don't have PR or citizenship, right? So mm-hmm. can I buy house due this status? Like, if I don't yes. have a PR, can I yes. can I buy
yeah.
house?
Yeah, you can. That's what we've been talking about, is the temporary resident. So you aren't considered a permanent resident, but do you have a working visa? You would have to work, correct?
Yes, I have work permit.
Yeah, so if you have a work visa, you're exactly the person that this new amendment applies to. You are exactly the person. It's someone who is not a permanent resident, but they have a working visa and they have certain requirements that lenders need. Pay statements, you have 90 days of having a down payment, you have the closing costs that we've been talking about. If you have those things, then that's what this amendment to that law, that it suits you particularly. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. And is this session recording? Or not?
Yeah.
Can I? Because
yeah.
I a little bit miss, and after
I
came after 20 minutes, so I didn't hear start of session. So I want to view this if it's possible. So
absolutely.
I would like to
record it.
Receive a record of this session. Thank you very much.
And welcome to Canada.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
As I told you, this information is really very, very important because, as I said, back home, we have rules and regulations how to buy houses. And here, when we come, it's different. That's why I really appreciate this information. Yeah. There is one question, the bank statement that needs to be at least 90 days should be only Canada bank account. I think it means the 90 days should be only in Canada, or they can be elsewhere. Or will you consider if it is in US-based bank account?
So if the 90 days in his, suppose if the person A is purchasing the property in Winnipeg, so the 90 days bank statement will be considered in their country under his name. So if he has another account, his own country, he can show us the proof. And then that money is showing a proof of wire money coming a week ago, we will consider it. But it should be his own name.
Okay.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Zarius, they're asking where they can watch the recording.
Oh, I will ask Cody. I will ask Cody. Maybe if we have their emails, we can send the recording. But I will confirm with Cody.
Is everyone on this who's listening to us, are they with New Journey Housing, or are they just the general public as well?
General public.
Yeah, so you probably want to get their email addresses in the chat.
If you can write your email in the chat so that we can send you the recording.
I would also like a copy of the recording if I can as well.
Yeah.
Oh, perfect.
Of course, if anyone has any additional questions after the fact, I'm sure the three of us are available for if you want to reach out to us by phone or email as well. So
yes.
I'll put my email address in, and Brian and Kieran, if you wanted to as well, then these folks have someone to talk to.
Yes. So I heard that the government helps Ukrainians who arrived by Kuwait with down payment. Is that true or not?
I think Cody, Brian, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think Cody had said that part of the program was ending. Wasn't that what she said, Brian?
I'm not sure. I can't recall. Kieran, do you recall?
She mentioned that something is going to be closed off.
Mm.
Yeah, I think they had put a certain amount aside, and I think
something 250,000 house, and this is the last year.
Right. Yeah. So I'm sorry, I don't know that answer specifically. I don't think either any of us do. So that might be a question for Cody.
We have a program. We have a program of down payment assistance, whereby we give 10,000 towards the down payment and 1,750 for closing costs for families with children, at least one child. And they are willing to purchase a house of maximum 275,000. It can be a little bit more depending on case by case, but it has to be approved by Manitoba Housing. But the maximum is 275,000. Yeah, and we have a family in the rural area, Ukrainian family in the rural area, and they will be qualified to get this assistance.
Does it have to be a house, Azarius, or can it be a condo or a townhouse?
It can be a condo or a house, yeah.
Okay, yeah. That's good to know.
Yes. And the family income, the household income, should be less than 84,600. Yeah. And it has to be their first home. They have to be first home buyer.
Mm.
I really want to thank you, Jennifer, Brian, and Kiran, for your time and your good presentation. We really learned a lot. And this buying a house here, I have seen there are a lot of rules and regulations. Yeah, so I really thank you for these wonderful presentations we have done. And in case our participants or any participant or any client to New Journey Housing, if they wanted another presentation, we are going to ask you again to be available for our participants, for our clients. And I really thank you for your time. I see it is 6:54. Then we are, it's almost 7. And thank you very, very much.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you.
One is asking, what is your email, Jennifer? Can you write, please?
I had put it in earlier. And then I think I answered Artem specifically.
Okay.
I think so. Did I not? Okay. Hold on. Don't let us go yet.
No.
Okay. One second here. Yes. Okay. I've sent that message now.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Much. Thank you so much. And yes, I'll be available.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Brian, Kieran.
Bye. Yeah. Thanks, Jennifer.
Okay. Bye.
Bye-bye.